गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल। टुडेज टॉपिक ऑफ डिस्कशन इज वीएलएसआई टेस्टिंग एंड एनालिसिस पार्ट 6। ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ दिस लेक्चर इज टू मेक द स्टूडेंट्स फैमिलियर विथ डिजाइन फॉर टेस्टेबिलिटी बिल्ट इन सेल्फ टेस्ट, दैट इज BIST। सो व्हाट इज दिस BIST? It is a built-in self-test. It is a mechanism that permits a machine to test itself. The engineers design BISTs to meet the requirements such as high reliability and lower repair cycle times. Or the constraints such as limited technician accessibility, cost of testing during manufacture, it can be reduced. The main purpose of BIST is to reduce the complexity and thereby decrease the cost and reduce the reliance upon external test equipment. BIST reduces the cost in two ways: reduces the test cycle duration, and second, reduces the complexity of the test or the probe setup by reducing the number of I/O signals that must be driven or examined under the tester control. Both leads to the reduction in hourly charges for the automated test equipment service. So these are the points which forms the basis for motivation to go for this BIST. So useful for the field test and diagnosis, less expensive than the local automatic test equipment. The software test for the field test and diagnosis, low hardware fault coverage, low diagnostic resolution, slow to operate, then hardware BIST benefits, lower system test effort, improved system maintenance and repair, improved component repair, better diagnosis. So benefits of this built-in self-test are the faults tested, single combinational or sequential stuckhead faults, delay faults, single stuckhead fault in the BIST hardware. And the benefits are reduced testing and maintenance cost, lower test generation cost, reduced storage or maintenance of test patterns, simpler and less expensive automatic test equipment, that is ATE, can test many units in parallel, shorter test application times, and can test at functional system speed. So definitions related to that. The important term is BILBO, that is the built-in logic block observer. The extra hardware added to flip-flops so they can be configured as the LFSR, that is linear feedback shift register pattern, which is a pattern generator or a response compactor, a scan chain or a flip-flop. So using this linear feedback shift register, we can prepare built-in logic block observer. The next important definition related to BIST is concurrent testing. The testing process that detects the faults during the normal system operation. So parallelly, the testing will be done. Then next is CUT, that is circuit under test. Next is exhaustive testing. So apply all possible 2 raised to n patterns to the circuit with n inputs. For example, if there are 10 inputs to the circuit, then we have to apply 2 raised to 10, that is 1024 number of patterns for the exhaustive testing of that circuit. Then irreducible polynomial, so Boolean polynomial that cannot be factored is called as the irreducible polynomial. Next important term is LFSR, that is the linear feedback shift register. So it is a hardware that generates the pseudo-random pattern sequence for the testing of the circuit. Next important definition is primitive polynomial. The Boolean polynomial P of X that can be used to compute increasing powers N of X raised to N modulo P of X to obtain all possible non-zero polynomial of degree less than PX. Then pseudo-exhaustive testing. The break circuit into small overlapping blocks and test each block exhaustively. Next is pseudo-random testing, that is algorithmic pattern generator that produces a subset of all possible tests with most of the properties of randomly generated patterns. Next important block is signature. Any statistical circuit property distinguishing between the bad and good circuit. It may be a set of digital bits. So it is compared with the actual response of the circuit, and then the decision regarding bad or good circuit can be taken. Next is TPG, that is the hardware test pattern generator. Now we'll see the details of this BIST procedure. So this BIST procedure can be made applicable at the different levels. It may be applicable at the system level, board level, or a chip level. If it is applicable at a chip level, then in the chip we have a extra hardware along with the actual logic that is implemented, and that extra hardware contains the blocks such as test controller, pattern generator, response analyzer, and then that chip will act as a circuit under test. Instead of chip as a circuit under test, we may have a board under test or a system under test, and to that again the similar extra block are required, that is test controller, pattern generator, and a response analyzer. So test controller, it is a hardware that activates self-test simultaneously on all PCBs, and each board controller activates parallel chip BIST diagnosis effective only if very high fault coverage. So what is this built-in self-test? The technique to incorporate the testing capability within the circuit itself. Generate a test vector, apply them to the circuit under test, and then check the response. So we have a circuit under test, that is the actual block. It may be IC or a chip, or it may be a circuit board, or it may be a system. To this circuit under test, we have to apply set of inputs which will be generated using a test pattern generator. So using this test pattern generator, we can apply set of inputs. This test pattern generator may be different circuits, like it may be some sequence generator, it may be some counter or a linear feedback shift register, with the help of which some pseudo random codes are generated and then they will be applied to the circuit under test. The output of this circuit under test is given to the test result compressor. So the signature of the result will be obtained and then that will be compared with the stored signature, which is the correct response of the circuit, and then according to the comparison results it is declared whether the circuit under test is good or bad. A small probability that signature of the faulty circuit with the same is same as the good circuit is called as aliasing or the error masking, and it is given by, so there are very few chances that the signature and the actual of the faulty circuit and that good circuit they will match, and the probability is very small, and that is p is equal to 2 raised to l minus r minus 1 divided by 2 raised to l minus 1, where l is the length of the test sequence, r is the length of signature register, and p is the probability of aliasing. So this is the BIST architecture. Now in this BIST architecture we have this, okay, well, there is one note regarding this BIST, that is BIST cannot test wires and transistors. So this circuit under test is the important block of which we want to do the testing. To the circuit under test we have to apply some set of inputs. Those inputs we can take from the hardware pattern generator or the external inputs, and there is one input multiplexer which will do the selection whether we have to take the inputs from the hardware pattern generator or we have to take the primary inputs from the external IO pins, and the operation of this input multiplexer is controlled with the help of a test controller. Test controller will decide whether the hardware pattern generator signal should be applied to the unit under test or the primary inputs from the external IO pins should be applied. So that is decided by using these two blocks. Then the next important block is the output response compactor. So as discussed earlier, based on the number of inputs, the number of test sets which will be applied to the unit under test may be very large. Like for example, if you take the smallest circuit which is having the 10 inputs, the number of possible combinations of inputs are 2 raised to 10, that is 1024, and those many set of outputs will also be generated. So it is very difficult to compare each and every output. Instead of that, the output response compactor block is there which will determine the signature from that particular set of outputs. Maybe if it is a 8-bit output and such 1024 outputs are there, then only the last and the second last bit will be taken, it will be XORed, and for each response, instead of taking 8-bit data, it will be converted to 1-bit, and then the signature will be obtained. So the data will be compacted, and that is done by using the output response compactor. The compacted data is called as the signature, and it is given as one of the input to the comparator. The comparator will take another reference signature from the ROM, that is the read-only memory, which is already stored. The correct response signature is already stored in the ROM. So this reference signature and the actual signature which is obtained from the output compact responser will be compared in the comparator, and the comparator will decide based on this reference signature and the signature comparison whether the unit under test is good or faulty. So that is decided by the comparator. All the blocks will be controlled using the test controller. So BIST cannot test wires and transistors from the primary inputs to the input mux, and from primary outputs to the output pins. So this is the overall BIST architecture. So we have a unit under test. The set of inputs will be applied to the unit under test either with the help of a hardware pattern generator or the primary outputs inputs from the external IO pins. And which input should be applied, that is decided based on the input multiplexer. The output response is given to the output response compactor, which will generate the signature of the produced set of outputs. It is given to the comparator. Comparator will take another reference signature from the ROM. It will compare the actual signature and the reference signature, and will declare whether the unit under test is good or faulty. Now this is one example circuit in which the test pattern is generated with the help of a LFSR, that is the linear feedback shift register. So what is this linear feedback shift register? A linear feedback shift register is a shift register whose input bit is a linear function of its previous state. The most commonly used linear function of single bit is exclusive OR. So you can see the plus sign box over here, that is nothing but a XOR function. So thus an LFSR is most often a shift register whose input bit is driven by a XOR of some bits of the overall shift register value, and the initial value of this LFSR is called the seed, and because the operation of the register is deterministic, the stream of values produced by the register is completely determined by its current state. And likewise, because the register has a finite number of possible states, it must eventually enter a repeating cycle. So after some time, the same data will be repeated. So this is one table in which we can see the output of this shift register. And this shift register will generate this particular pattern. So initially all zeros, and then we can see after some time the data will be repeated. So either we can go for the pseudo-random generator, weighted test generator, or adaptive test generator. So this is the, we can say the equation for the shift register. And this shift register is also called as a Fibonacci LFSR. So based on this polynomial, it will generate a particular pattern. So for the first case, we have the polynomial x cube plus x plus 1. Here, the coefficients of all these polynomials are equal to 1. So this is the output of this feedback shift register, which is the output is taken from the most significant bit. And then here we have x cube and x, those two things are there. And this is another second case in which the polynomial x is x cube plus x square plus 1. So we have this x cube, the last flip-flop, and this second last it is XOR. So X cube and XOR, that is XORed, and then that is given as a feedback. Now here in this case it is X cube plus X. So this is X cube and this one is X. So here we are getting X cube, then X square and X. So as the polynomial is X cube plus X, so output of this last flip flop and this first flip flop, they are XORed and then given as a feedback. And here it is X cube plus X square. So this is X cube and this is X square. It is XORed and then given as a feedback. And the patterns which will be generated, they are given in this particular table. So this linear feedback register is generating the random sequences and then that will act as a test input for our circuit under test. So we have studied this term BILBO, that is built-in logic block observer. So the same circuit which just now we have seen, that is linear feedback shift register, so that can be configured to perform the different task. Like this is a linear feedback shift register which is acting as a pattern generator. The same circuit, that is linear feedback shift register, can also act like a response compactor. And then we have this circuit under test. So this BILBO, it is having four different modes. It can act as a flip-flop, it can act as a linear feedback shift register pattern generator, linear feedback shift register response compactor, and a scan chain for flip-flops. So this is a generic built-in self-test scheme in which we have a circuit to be tested. A multiplexer is there which will select the input from the IO pins or from a test pattern generator. And then we have a response monitor and then the error signal. This is a particular self-test circuit for a memory, that is a RAM. Now for this RAM testing, what we need is we have a address counter which will generate the addresses, and here we have a write data generator which will write some data and then that we can write in this memory, and then we have a read data generator also. So this is a BIST controller which will control this built-in self-test activity of the RAM. Using this write data generator, some data is generated which can be written in the memory. At which location this data is to be written, that is decided by the address counter. So address counter will start from all zeros and it will go up to all ones. And at every memory location, at every address, the data will be written in the RAM. And we have a data out of this RAM. So the RAM data will be available over here. We have a read data generator, so which can read the data from the RAM, and then this is the original data and this is the actual data from the RAM. It will be compared using the comparator. If both data are matching, means the memory test is okay. If it is not matching, memory test is failed, and then accordingly it will send the data to the BIST controller. Thank you.